morning, everyone, and welcome back to this edition of Bringing Out the Ed, brought to you by Cooper Medical Command. My name is Dr. Jonathan Barr, also known as MD4, and this time we'll be tackling the challenging and somewhat controversial topic of hyperactive delirium with severe agitation. What are we going to be talking about today? First, we're going to define what this syndrome is. We'll define the goals of pre-hospital treatment, review your initial therapeutic options, and then discuss the underlying causes and triggers of this disease process. So first, we have to define what this is. Most of us probably imagine someone who looks like this: superhuman strength, extremely agitated, extremely violent, yelling really loudly. But officially, this disease has a definition. It was defined in the American College of Emergency Physicians, also known as ACEP 2021 Task Force Report, as a presentation marked by disorientation and aggressive words and or actions that is an acute life-threatening medical condition that requires emergency medical treatment. Now, I bring you this definition because you may see in the popular press or in other medical bodies questions about whether or not this syndrome exists. But for us as emergency providers, the American College of Emergency Physicians does define a syndrome. They call it hyperactive delirium with severe agitation. And it's a condition that I think we've all seen in this world and that we need to know how to manage. I do also want to state here that we're going to focus on the medical management and medical aspects of this, not in any political or social discussions on this topic. That's outside the scope of this presentation. So some of us may have heard these other terms thrown around, excited delirium or agitated delirium. We're going to again use the ACEP terminology of hyperactive delirium with severe agitation in this talk. So first, what is this syndrome? It's characterized by disordered thinking, psychomotor agitation, and a hyperadrenergic state. And in that hyperadrenergic state, the patients are often combative. They may be violent or have loud outbursts of speech. So when you encounter these patients, what are your goals? Let's take a step back and look at what you're trying to accomplish here in the pre-hospital setting. First and foremost, when I was first in EMT school, the very first thing we were taught is that the most important person on scene is me. The safety of yourself and your crew is paramount, as is the safety of the patient and everyone else. So step one is keep yourself safe. So we want to make sure everyone is safe. Step two is we want to prevent morbidity and mortality in the patient. This is an acute life-threatening condition. And so we're looking to prevent morbidity and mortality here. And then lastly, ultimately, in order to accomplish all this, we basically want the patient to go to sleep. If we can get the patient to go to sleep safely, this is a win for EMS, and this is a successful treatment of this, and this will allow us then to come back to the patient and reassess them later, hopefully when they've been calmed down. So how are we going to accomplish this? What are our therapeutic options here? So in order to understand the therapeutic options, you have to understand that this disease runs on a spectrum. They may be like this match on the left side of the screen with a little bit of fire. It's not too hard to manage. It burns itself out in a few seconds, or you could blow it out easily. Or they may start to get to this picture in the middle, the burned popcorn, right? Now this is a little bit of fire in your apartment. It's setting the smoke alarms off. Everyone has to evacuate the building. The fire department's coming. You can't ignore this. This isn't going to burn itself out. This has to be addressed. You have to do something about this condition. And then lastly, you may find yourself in a situation like this where you have a fully involved structure fire, the house is burning down, there's immediate life threats that need to be addressed. And so that's this last condition here. And we'll discuss your therapeutic options to manage this full spectrum of disease. So first is that match, that little fire there, and this may respond to verbal redirection only. You could think of this as your drunk college student, someone who partied a little too hard, but they're not, you know, causing major disruptions. They're not really dangerous to anyone. They maybe could have even slept it off at home, but now they're in front of you. They're in your ambulance and you have to deal with the situation. And these patients often you can verbally have a conversation with. And that's the key thing, is you can have a conversation with patients at this level of disease. So try to have a conversation with them, redirect them, and that may be all you need in this case. Now we're starting to escalate a little bit. We're into that burned popcorn situation. You need to do something to address the situation. You can't have a reasonable conversation with the patient. Verbal redirection has failed, and you may need to apply physical restraints. Now, I want you to consult your local protocol for how you should apply restraints on these patients, but I want to show you what not to do here. Do not hogtie the patient. Do not put them in handcuffs behind their back and do not apply leather restraints or a straitjacket type restraint that restricts the chest. All these positions have been associated with morbidity and mortality in the patient and should be avoided in all cases. Next, once you've gotten the patient to a point where you can do this, apply a non-rebreather. Just put it on. This is going to do multiple things for you. First, it's going to control spit. Second, it's going to pre-oxygenate the patient in case you need to manage the airway later. And third, it may fix the problem. Maybe this patient is agitated and delirious because they're hypoxic. And so the non-rebreather is your friend in these circumstances, so put one on as soon as the situation allows. Next, now we're at the point where we need to do something more to get this patient under control for everyone's safety, for the patient's morbidity and mortality. The more they thrash around, the more this smoke goes off, the more the situation escalates, the more likely they are to have complications either respiratory-wise or they could also get rhabdomyolysis. This is the time where you're going to reach for your Haldol and a benzodiazepine. So let's talk about each of those. So first, haloperidol is an antipsychotic medication. It's usually given in this situation intramuscularly at a dose of 5 milligrams. However, you should consult your local protocol for the exact dosing. It does produce sedation, but it also has some negative effects that you should be aware of. One, it is a QT prolonging medication. So if your patient is on other QT prolonging medications, or if they have congenital long QT syndrome, this could lead to the dangerous arrhythmia called torsades. And you need to be aware of this and put the patient on a cardiac monitor as soon as is practical in the situation to monitor for this life-threatening arrhythmia. You can also get acute dystonic reactions with haloperidol, and that's something you should be aware of. These are involuntary, often spasmodic movements. They're very uncomfortable, usually not dangerous. The treatment for them is 50 milligrams of IV Benadryl. While the dystonic reactions are typically not dangerous, they can also have dystonic reactions in the larynx, which could be life-threatening in terms of the airway. Again, be aware of this, put the patient on the monitor, have the pulse ox on, have Entidol on as soon as you can in these type of patients to monitor for this complication. Now you see lorazepam in this picture, and that's used oftenly in this type of situation. I'm going to argue that in the pre-hospital setting, a better choice for you is midazolam. A typical dose is going to be given at 5 milligrams intramuscularly, although consult your local protocol for the exact dosage. This is going to produce sedation. It will also potentially produce respiratory and CNS depression. This is important, especially in mixed with co-intoxicants such as narcotics. As such, again, put the patient on the monitor the respiratory status, have that non-rebreather on, put the Entidol on. These are all going to be steps you could take to minimize the risk of harm in this situation. Now, one other thing is you can try to be a little selective with these depending on what you think the underlying cause is. If you think it's a psychiatric condition, you're going to more often reach for haloperidol. That's going to be better. That being said, we often don't know, or we need more sedation and you're going to use both. But something to keep in mind, I tend to prefer midazolam in things like cocaine or drug ingestions and haloperidol in psychiatric disease. And in all cases, sometimes you're going to need both. But just keep in mind that, you know, you could try to choose one first over the other depending on the situation. In many situations, you're going to just end up giving both. So now we're in a little bit of a worse situation. We're fully involved structure fire now. There is immediate danger. The patient is not just disruptive anymore. They're not just smoldering. They're now actually, there's an acute danger. We need the patient to be sedated immediately. And the choice for this is ketamine. A common dosage is 4 to 6 mgs per kg IM ketamine. Consult your local dosing protocol. Typically the max dose is 500 milligrams. However, consult your local protocol for the exact dosing. Ketamine is going to cause a dissociative anesthetic effect. In patients who have circulating catecholamines, it may raise your heart rate and blood pressure. In patients who are catecholamine depleted because they're in shock, this will not happen. Also, keep in mind that while ketamine tends to preserve the respiratory drive, you can have laryngospasm, which may be life-threatening. Should you have laryngospasm in the setting of ketamine, the initial treatment is positive pressure ventilation with a bag valve mask. If that's insufficient to open it up, you may need to administer succinylcholine and intubate the patient. Keep in mind that this is relatively rare, but you should be aware of it and monitor for this potentially life-threatening side effect of the ketamine. So now you've given your Haldol and your benzo, you've given your ketamine, you're done, right? You can just drop the mic, ride to the hospital, patient went to sleep, success, high fives all around, right? Wrong. You now have to look for the underlying cause of why did this happen to the patient. Okay, there are many reasons why patients can have hyperactive delirium. The first I mentioned is the hypoxia, so hopefully you put the non-rebreather on at this point and have already corrected for that. Hypercarbia is also another possibility. Maybe they weren't breathing well and they need some ventilatory assistance with your bag valve mask or other methods. Hypoglycemia. Now the patient's calm enough, check a sugar. Maybe their sugar is 10 and they just need some D10 or D50, depending on your local protocol, to correct this. Maybe they were hyperperfused and their brain wasn't getting enough blood, and that's why they're acting this way, and you need to start a line, get some fluids, work on treating causes of shock. Traumatic brain injury or intracranial hemorrhage is also a cause of this, especially in trauma, and so you should be aware of this. Sepsis, meningitis can cause this in particular, as well as toxins, drugs, or drug withdrawal syndrome such as alcohol withdrawal. And also don't forget about the thyroid. Thyroid storm or thyroid toxicosis can present like this. And so you're going to get the patient over to the hospital at this point now that you've done the rest of your workup. So let's sum up the key points in this. So first, hyperactive delirium with agitation is recognized by the American College of Emergency Physicians and is life-threatening and should be taken seriously. Next, provider and patient safety is paramount. Make sure to keep yourself and everyone safe. To do that, you may need to apply physical restraints and or chemical sedation. Keep in mind that these are dangerous and require close monitoring of the patient to avoid the patient from worsening. We also have to remember that hyperactive delirium is a dangerous state, and so you have to weigh the risks and benefits here, and oftentimes your best option is to use this. And then last but not least, remember and do not forget to evaluate for the underlying cause and treat it when possible, because this is really the key thing here, is get at the underlying cause of why is the patient acting like this. For more information on this, Ruben Strayer gives a good talk, and I've included the link here. He talks a lot about droperidol, which is not widely available and not in many pre-hospital protocols. But if you want to take this one step further and want to learn more and dive deeper into this topic, I've included the link here so you can check out his lecture. Thank you guys for listening in. Stay safe.